A family or a clan is a place where people can feel they belong, surrounded by people from their own blood, tied by fate as siblings and relatives, where support, pride, and honor can be felt. But just as bright that might sound and how lovely it would be for most clans to be like that, it unfortunately isn't. A clan or a family might be corrupted and toxic just as much they can be peaceful and good to be in. Whether it's political scandals, misunderstandings, discrimination, need for survival, or just pure evil, some families are truly messed up, misguided, corrupted, and in this video's case, cursed. The Zennin are a conservative clan that values power over all else, and due to that over-exaggerated worth put on power and people who have it, it gave birth to extreme expectations, oppression and sexism. If you aren't lucky enough to be born with a powerful hereditary technique, then you are essentially worthless. You bring shame to your parents, something that is so out of your control, yet you are punished for the entirety of your life. Limited from dreams and spending your life as either a servant for females or low-level fighters that train in martial arts for males. Even when you attempt to leave, nothing but pain, regret, and emptiness awaits you. Faced with only two options, stay and suffer or leave and also suffer. People are driven to either accept their fate and go with it, or the few minority that are able to force their way through the chains and bonds of the so-called family they are born into. Toji chose the path of isolation, cutting his ties with his blood completely, leaving the clan and leaving his kid after the loss of his wife. He essentially went on his own twisted way of revenge for what the clan did to him, becoming a mercenary who kills sorcerers. He claims and pretends to have left everything behind, yet he still acts against his normal behavior in order to prove his worth, and he still has feelings for his kid, his last words being a hint to protect him, and even protecting him yet again after that. More about Toji in an individual analysis I made about him already. Make sure to check it out if you haven't, link in the description below. Not too similar yet the same is the case with Maki, who left on her own way of reclaiming respect and gaining strength, but unlike Toji, she couldn't leave everything behind. Her whole vision was about coming back and reclaiming the seat of the head, after she proves her strength and controlling the very place that she despises, in order to make a place where her sister feels she belongs. Not just her sister, but her half, Mai. The two of them are the biggest example of all the pain that the Zennin clan can inflict on people that are born weak. They suffer from all the problems and discriminations possible. Abuse, sexism, bullying, shaming, disgust, and more. Being the daughters of a very pure personification of the conservative and the abusive methods and ideals of the clan, from valuing power and control above all else, even his own blood, just goes to show that Maki and Mai aren't the only ones who probably suffer like this, that this is a shared mentality running through their blood, a curse that separates and causes corruption and blindness, as their mother, who is a servant, listening to her daughters being objectified and disrespected. Yet she can't do or say anything against it. She is powerless against this system of twisted traditions, as she is told that a woman that can't walk 3 steps behind a man should be stabbed in the back and killed. And from the very few male characters we know of, this isn't rare. Almost every male character from the clan we got to see enough of shows signs of this corruption and sexism, other than Ranta, who looks like the only pure and good out of them. He seems like a product of traditions that just follows orders, not being like others, or so I'd like to think, because we didn't get to know him more, and he has only few lines, as he only appeared in one chapter. But going from his appearance and what little we saw of him, we can tell he isn't rotten, like Jinichi Nobuaki, Oji, and lastly the pure idealistic manifestation of everything that the Zenin clan is. Naoya Zenin. Naoya represents everything that the Zenin are. He is full of himself, disrespectful, cunning, and abusive. He is the result of the opposite end of the spectrum in the clan. Unlike Maki, Mai, and Toji, who are the outcasts, he is the pride. He is what happens when someone meets those expectations, inheriting the technique of his father, the previous head, and being the most likely to take his place. His outfit and his Kansai accent are also reflections of the traditions and conservative ways of the clan. When he realizes that the seat of the head is going to be taken away from him by Megumi due to a certain contract his father had with Toji, he becomes frustrated and immediately sets out to kill him. Kill someone he doesn't know for the sake of himself, showing how little value he sees in human lives aside from his. The way he learns that his father passed away, yet he only cared about the news that had something to do with him. The way he looked down on Maki and bullied her as a kid. He is the Zenin clan at its purest. When Gojo was sealed, Naobito, the previous head, only showed interest in how it will make the Gojo clan weaker, which benefits them. Didn't care about how that will literally affect the whole world. They are a clan of interest, and they ended up being the one taken down from the seat of the big three clans, or at least what the other clans demanded, after a certain monster destroyed them completely. And that monster is none other than their creation. Just as Naoya is the epitome of the pride of the clan, Maki is the opposite. She is the unwanted, the disappointment, and that soon leads to her becoming more powerful. Just like Toji, the removal of all cursed energy she had granted her immeasurable power. She went and killed all present members of the clan, small and big. No one stood a chance as she single-handedly annihilated them. Killed all members of the Hei squad, and all that was left for her to destroy was their leader, Naoya himself. A final clash between the top of the clan and the bottom of it. The pride versus the shame. This is the climax of the clan's survival. Is it going to be destroyed completely, or is there still hope of revival? As they fight, Naoya not giving Maki any chance to react or move, overwhelming her with his speed, going all out because he learned from his encounter with Choso not to underestimate people. At first he seems to have the upper hand, but then Maki surprises him with a counter punch because she was counting his movement and breaking down his technique, which enables him to make 24 movements per second. She one-shots him and leaves him to die. Naoya had all his beliefs shattered. Against Choso, his take on brotherhood and family was disproved. The one person who doesn't care about family versus the one who only cares about family. He was looked down on by Yuta. Even with the power he is so proud of, he was powerless against someone much more powerful than he is, relying on him to treat his wounds. Even as a kid, he was excited to see the loser that is called Toji. When he heard so much about him and came to see how miserable and weak he must be. Only to his surprise, he sees the Chad that Toji is. From then, he idealized him and Toji became his hero. The same thing kept happening to him until his final fight against Maki, someone who is exactly like Toji. But she is a female, and he learned that she can't stand equal to him. She is worthless. A throwback to something that Nobara said in chapter 42, when Yuji asked her, why doesn't the clan just accept Maki? Because she is strong. She told him that they don't want to accept something they already rejected. They are stupid that way. And that is exactly what happened with Naoya. If he likes and respects Toji so much, then why not accept Maki, who is the same now? When he was barely able to survive after that, he was killed by Maki's mother, as she walked behind him and stabbed him in the back. A throwback to how he told her that any woman who can't follow a man should be stabbed in the back. Irony at its finest. Maki and Mai's mother seems heartless at first, but sooner we realize that she also was just like them. She was powerless and she suffered her entire life, longer than they did. She just accepted it as reality. But after all, she still loved her daughters and was glad that she gave birth to them. And their foolish father Oji, who was the victim of Maki's rage. In fact, the first one to be cut by her new blade, by the very daughters he called a stain in his life. I believe Naoya will come back as a vengeful cursed spirit, because he still has more to serve in the story, and he was killed by a non-cursed object. Until then, the state of the Zenin clan is vague. Maki can't be the leader because there is no one to lead, and she only wanted that for Mai, and Mai died. Fushiguro is the current head of the clan, but that is not as simple as it sounds. What is clear now is that the clan was destroyed because of a sister's promise, and it's fair to say that they destroyed themselves, literally because Maki was one of them who did it, and thematically because of everything I mentioned in this video. If you like this video, there is a whole playlist with Jujutsu Kaisen character analysis, just like this one on the channel. Subscribe if you haven't, and as always, many thanks for watching.